Good morning, all of you. I welcome you all to Grade Up and I welcome you to the second session of our series Fun with Vocabulary. Today, we are going to talk about words that have come from Greek mythology. So, Greek mythology, just like Indian mythology, in Indian mythology we have Ramayana, Mahabharata. So, Greek mythology is also very rich in a similar way. Okay. And a lot of words from those stories, the names of the characters from those stories, they have given birth to a lot of words that are now widely used in English language. So today we are going to talk about them. Plus, we are going to look at some common question formats in your entrance exams, vocabulary question formats in your various entrance exams. Okay, so hitting two birds with one stone. That's what we are going to do. All right. So, just give me a second. Yeah, sorry. This was the slide that should have been there. Right. So, I welcome you to the vocabulary marathon again. I am Nikita. I'm a VRC expert. Okay. So, I've been taking a lot of editorial sessions lately. So, we take excerpts there. So, I keep getting confused between excerpts and experts. Right. Okay. So, picture to show you the Greek legacy, but they were just not just warriors, okay? There was a lot more to Greek mythology. So we'll see some of those interesting stories today. Right, let me see how many of you've joined. Okay, good afternoon, Pratishta. Good afternoon, Kaushal. Right, let's go to our slides. So this is our schedule, YouTube schedule. I'm sure those who attended the editorial session, you have already noted it down. Those who didn't, here's the schedule for Saturday. We have an LRDI session at 6 today. Then we have a special session again at 10 p.m. today. Okay, this is tomorrow's schedule. Okay, now today we have a special session. Let me just talk to you about that on YouTube at 9 p.m. Okay, I'll see you all. In case you're targeting IIFT, you should attend this session. Okay, so an IIFT 19 student, someone who cracked IIFT 19 is coming with us, Ayush. Okay, he'll talk to you about how he scored it, the strategy, the preparation, and also his interview experience. Right, so join me at 9 today. Tomorrow, similarly, we have a session particularly for cracking VARC. So, in case the verbal section poses a problem for you, then you should attend this session tomorrow at 7:30. Okay? Now, this is my schedule in case you are interested in attending and getting to know about some troubling passages. Okay? Let's say how to tackle a troubling passage. So, I'll pick up a passage from CAT 2020, a passage that troubled students, okay, and then I'll tell you how you should have attempted it. So, this is on GradeUp app, okay, it's a GradeUp exclusive. So, at 5 p.m., I'll see you today, right? Okay. Yes, this goes without saying. I keep on telling this in every session. Okay, if you find value in the session, if you enjoy it, if you like it, then do show this appreciation. Okay, it means a lot to us, right? And in case you have any suggestions, any feedback, you can comment it in the comment section. Share it with your friends. I'm sure you'll enjoy today's session. So share it with your friends. They'll also learn vocabulary in a fun way. Otherwise, I know that learning vocabulary can be a bit boring, right? And do subscribe to our channel to receive such automatic content updates. Okay. All right. Now, so look at this picture. Okay. What do you interpret? Aman, this is a vocabulary session. So, of course, in MHCET, you do get quite a few vocabulary questions, right? You get them in the, you can get them in the format of fill in the blanks, right? Synonym, antonym. So, yes, this will help you a lot there as well. Okay, we'll see some questions also. It's not just my telling you meanings of words, right? Okay, so this picture, when you look at it, what do you interpret from this picture? There's this person. This person looks like a king from the crown. He's sitting here on a pile of gold, right? And there's this girl here who has also turned into a statue of gold, right? So this king is Midas. Midas was a king in Greek mythology who asked gods. Okay, so the gods were happy with him and they asked him that, okay, what do you want? We'll grant your wish. Ask a wish. So he said that let everything I touch be turned into gold. Okay, that's what he asked. So Midas touch today is used to refer to something that, let's say there's this person who whichever venture he gets into, kuch bhi kaam karta, he succeeds. He can make money out of any venture. So this person is said to have a Midas touch, because whatever he's touching is in a way turning into gold. So this is a Midas touch. It's used commonly in business circles, right? And so Midas, of course, in the story later on, he regretted it and he asked the gods to take that wish back. Okay, so he said that, no, I don't want it. My daughter is turned into gold. That's one version of the story. In another version, his food turns into gold. So he's no longer able to eat. Right. So that actually brings him back to senses that, see, I have been greedy. Okay. So Midas touch, the uncanny ability to turn every venture that you step in into a profitable venture. Right? Okay, because we are talking about gold, alchemy, right? So this another term came to my mind, Goldilocks situation. Okay, so what is a Goldilocks situation? This comes from a fairy tale. It's not from Greek mythology, but it's a fairy tale. So there are these three bears, okay, living in the forest, and one day a woman, Goldilocks, visits them. Okay, so she examines the possessions of each of the three bears, Mama Bear, Papa Bear, and the Baby Bear. And then she declares that the Baby Bear's possessions, porridge, a bed, okay, these are the things that he has. So they are just right. She says they are just the right amount. So Goldilocks situation is that situation when something you possess is in just the right amount. Okay, the optimal balanced situation is a Goldilocks situation. Okay, so for instance, scientists, let's say, have found a new planet and they say that its position is akin to a Goldilocks situation. It is neither too hot nor too cold, right? So two words related to gold, right? And what is alchemy? I'm sure you've heard this word. The Alchemist is a popular novel. So alchemy is earlier, you know, we didn't have science as a separate branch. Okay, it emerged as a separate branch much later. Earlier, it was a part of philosophy. Okay, it was a part of alchemy. So alchemy was said to be the ability to turn metals into gold. A lot of people tried it, but were unsuccessful. Right? So the ability to turn metals into gold, right? That is alchemy. So three new words that are associated with gold in some way. You could also associate them with this story if that helps you to remember them, right? Let's see a couple of more words and then we'll see our first question. Okay, so aphrodisiac and hermaphrodite, right? So both have afro in them, right? Actually, Aphrodite was a Greek goddess. Okay? She was the Greek goddess of sexual love. Right? So an aphrodisiac is any food or drink that stimulates sexual desire. Okay? Because they come after the name of Aphrodite, the goddess of sexual love. So see here, there are these foods. Oysters are said to be aphrodisiacs. Strawberries are said to be aphrodisiacs, right? So these are foods or drugs that stimulate sexual desire, come from Aphrodite. Now, this is a very interesting story. Where does the term hermaphrodite comes from, right? It's actually a combination of two names. People do this these days. They name their children by combining their own names, right? Something similar happened to Hermes and Aphrodite. Hermes was the spouse of Aphrodite, husband uska. So they had a child. Okay, Hermaphroditus. That's what they named him. Now, this child of theirs fell in love with a वॉटर स्पिरिट, देर यूज टू बी दी स्पिरिट्स ऑफ वेरियस नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज. सो वॉटर की एक स्पिरिट थी एंड हर्मोफ्रोडिटस फेल इन लव विद हर, बोथ फेल इन लव विद ईच अदर. सो दिस वॉटर स्पिरिट शी प्रेड दैट लेट हर्मोफ्रोडिटस बी यूनाइटेड विद मी परमानेंटली. सो गॉड एक्चुअली फ्यूज्ड देयर बॉडीज इन टू वन. गॉड ग्रांटेड दैट विश एंड फ्यूज्ड देयर बॉडीज इन टू वन एंड that from there comes this term hermaphrodite. An organism, a plant or an animal that possesses the characteristics of both male and female, sexual organs, other characteristics of both males and females is called a hermaphrodite. Okay, so the picture that I have here, this is of hermaphrodite cannabis. Okay, marijuana cannabis. So, cannabis plants are either male or female, right? Usually they're either male or female, but sometimes in stressful situations, they turn into hermaphrodite to ensure their survival. So, kya hota hai? Dekho, female part hai flower, male part hai is pollen sac. So, they self-pollinate. They pollinate themselves so that they can survive better, right? So, this is a property that is present in organisms, in plants, it's present in animals as well, in human beings as well. Okay, all from the name of Aphrodite. Okay, so two new words here. Now, this is interesting. Look at this cartoon. So, there's this person carrying a boulder up a hill. Okay, and look at this. Look at what he's saying. Student loans. This boulder actually represents his student loans. This is related to this word Sisyphean. Okay, it comes from the name of Sisyphus. Okay, so kaun tha Sisyphus? Any guesses? Sisyphus. Again, he was a soldier, a warrior. Okay, so Sisyphus was a warrior. And uska story kya hai? He somehow defied the gods. Okay, so he did something that angered the gods. And the gods, what punishment they gave him? They gave him this punishment that you have to carry a boulder up a hill. What will happen when you carry a boulder up a hill? Okay, so if it's a pointed hill, the boulder will again fall down. Right, the boulder won't stay there. The boulder will again fall down. So it became a never-ending task for him. Okay, it was a never-ending punishment. He was just doomed to carry it up the hill. Then it would roll down. Then he would carry it up again. Right. So Sisyphean task is a never-ending task. Something that just goes on forever, and you don't like this. Right. A Sisyphean task. So the word carries a negative connotation. Positive word nahi hai ye, right? So don't tell your lovers, you don't tell them that, you know, my love for you is Sisyphean. That would not fit here, right? Okay, Herculean. So a Herculean task. Okay, there's a bicycle also named Hercules. So it is, you can associate it with this cartoon. That's why I put it here. It comes from another Greek warrior, Hercules. Hercules was known to possess a lot of strength. Okay. So he was a very strong warrior. So a Herculean task is a task that demands a lot of strength from you. An arduous task. Remember, we learned the word arduous in our last session on vocabulary. Something that's difficult, that demands a lot of strength from you, is a Herculean task. Okay. So you've learned these words. This one is based on gold. Then we have two words based on the goddess Aphrodite. Then we have Sisyphean and Herculean. Now, let's see a question. So this is your question. Fill in the blanks, right? And I want you to fill in the right blank here. Yes. Fill in the right word. Correct, Pratishtha. Correct, Aditya. He was doomed to do this. Yes. Okay. Let's see what you mark here. Waiting for your responses in the chat box. So I'm timing you, giving you 30 seconds for this. Okay, I've got three responses. Okay, four responses. Five. All right. Okay. Okay. Okay, so A, D, and I've got one C. Okay, and okay, I've got one B also. So, sab kuch hi aage answers mein. Let's see. So, as the dissenters, I highlighted this word. Let's discuss its meaning. The dissenters, dissent. When you don't agree with someone, you dissent, right? So dissenters, people who don't agree on a particular matter with someone, right? So as the dissenters were asked to resign, so let's say there was a group in which certain people didn't agree with the larger group, so they were asked to resign. The other party members looked at them with a dash of. The other party members, so we are talking about a party, they looked at them with an awe, wonder. So if awe itself means wonder, then astonished can't be the answer, right? Lethargic means lazy. So can we have a lazy wonder? No, doesn't fit. Either C or D. I have just explained to you the meaning of Sisyphean. Okay, they looked at them with a never-ending awe. Does that fit with the context? They are dissenters, they are rebellious people, right? So basically, even D could be eliminated here because never-ending awe does not fit here. We are talking about a moment and we are focusing on their rebelliousness. The answer is C, Promethean. Okay, which is going to be our next word. So Sisyphean does not fit here. Promethean is the answer. Now, guess the meaning of Promethean. They looked at them with a dash awe. Promethean awe. So basically, Prometheus, let's learn about him, who he was. He was a titan. So in Greek mythology, you know, there are categories of gods. So there are Olympians, there are titans. So Prometheus was a titan. He was known to be rebellious and innovative. So he was rebellious and innovative. And he was very intellectual, genius also. So it is said that he actually created human beings from clay. Of course, we are doing mythology, right? So we are talking about myths here. So it is said that Prometheus created human beings from clay. He was an advocate of humankind. And he actually, the gods didn't want humans to have fire, okay? But he stole fire from the gods and gifted it to humanity, gifted it to human beings. So he is also called the god of fire, Prometheus, right? So they looked at him, they looked at those members with a Promethean awe, okay? A wonder that how rebellious and daring these people are, right? So that's the word Promethean, comes from the story of Prometheus. Okay. Now, what do you see here? Yes, Rijita, absolutely correct. Somebody who is rebelliously creative is also called Promethean. Prometheus was creative and innovative. Promethean, yes, it has a positive connotation. It's not a negative word. Okay, the rebellious part would always stay with it. But yes, you call someone disruptively, rebelliously creative, innovative. Right? Yes, we see a maze in this picture, right? Absolutely correct, Aditya. So, a maze is also called a labyrinth. Okay, and there's a very amazing Greek story behind it. There was a popular architect called Daedalus. I hope I'm spelling him right. I think there's an A here. Okay, Daedalus. So, Dedalus was known to create some very beautiful architectural marvels. Okay, so once the king of the regime in which Dedalus lived, he was attacked by a monster called Minotaur. The monster came into the city, okay, Minotaur, and Minotaur was a half human, half animal, mythical creature, right? So in order to tame Minotaur, in order to capture Minotaur, the king asked Dedalus to create a maze that Minotaur can't get out of. Usko way out hi nahi mil paaye. Okay. So Dedalus, through his architectural genius, created such a maze. This maze was called Labyrinth. So from then on, Labyrinth has become synonymous with maze. But the story doesn't end here. Now the king became worried. See, of course, Dedalus knows the way out. Usi ne design kara, usko to pata, right? So the king became worried. What if Dedalus cheats? What if he releases Minotaur? So he imprisoned Dedalus. Acha, I have to write here. He imprisoned Dedalus along with Dedalus's son Icarus. He imprisoned both of them in a dungeon. This dungeon was covered by sea. I mean, it was surrounded by sea. Right. So now Dedalus kept thinking, kaise bahar jaye, kaise bahar nikle? So he built wings of wax. He built wings of wax. Okay. In the dungeon. Now he gave these wings to his son Icarus and told him to fly over the sea. Okay. Using these wings of wax. But he warned Icarus to not to fly too near the sun. Sun ke paas jayega to wax ke wings hain. Kya hoga? Right? So he warned Icarus that he don't fly too near the sun. Icarus said, okay. Icarus flew. Now it was a very smooth flight. Icarus was enjoying it. Usko bahut acha lagne laga and he kept soaring higher and higher without paying attention to his father's warning. And as a result, the wings melted. He drowned into the sea. Okay. So this Icarus effect or Icarus paradox, this is a very popular term, particularly in the fields of, again, business and economics. So initially, you know, some companies, they succeed like nobody's business. They succeed like anything. They soar higher and higher. But then the very factors that led them to become successful lead to their downfall. That is what is called the Icarus effect or Icarus paradox for these companies. Okay. So you can, there are a lot of examples like this. Okay. Sony, although of course the brand is not non-existent, but at one point it was much more successful than it is today, right? So there are a number of examples here. You can search for them. So Labyrinth, Icarus. All right, let's see. Then you've read the story in school. Good. Yes. Correct. Absolutely. Okay. Another question for you. It makes use of labyrinth. Labyrinthine would be an adjective, which would mean maze-like or having the quality of a maze. Okay. So now see and tell me what should be the answer. Kodak, yes. BlackBerry, good Kisanu, good examples. Okay, let me see what you say. Looking at the chat box. Okay, good. Pratishta has answered. Others? Vijita has answered. Okay. Pratishta, B for sure. Okay. Sita says D. Okay. B. Sahiti says, Aman says C. So I've got B, C. And I've also got one D. Achha, sari options aa gaye. A does not fit, right? It, they can't be maze-like feathers. So I think A you rejected easily. Okay. Unsightly. Un, negative, prefix, sightly. Something you don't like the sight of. ओके दैट इज अनसाइटली. पिकॉक के फेदर्स तो नहीं होते, पिकक्स फीट आर अगली. ओके पिकक्स फेदर्स आर नॉट अगली. ओके सो इरिडेसेंट मुशी. मुशी हैज टू मीनिंग्स. वन इज पल्पी, एनीथिंग दैट्स वेरी सॉफ्ट पल्पी इज मुशी. द अदर इज सेंटिमेंटल और रोमांटिक, दैट इज द अदर मीनिंग. दे डोंट फिट, डे भी नहीं फिट कर रहा. द आंसर इज इरिडेसेंट. ओके सम ऑफ यू आर श्योर अबाउट इट बिकॉज यू हैव हर्ड दिस वर्ड अर्लियर, राइट. सो एज आई टोल्ड यू रीडिंग हेल्प्स. ओके कॉन्शियसली लर्निंग वोकैबुलरी हेल्प्स. सो लेट्स सी वेयर डज दिस वर्ड इरिडेसेंट कम फ्रॉम. Iridescent comes from Iris. Iris was in Greek mythology the goddess of rainbow. Okay, goddess of rainbow, and she was also a messenger of gods. Messenger of gods. Okay, so she used to carry God's messages to each other at the speed of wind. Okay, and she was the goddess of rainbow. So iridescent, that's why colorful. Iridescent is something that's very colorful, such that things change color when you look at them from various angles. That is iridescent. Okay, all right. Do female peacocks have feathers? They don't have such rich feathers as males do. Okay. दे डू ऐसा नहीं है, बिल्कुल नहीं होते हैं, बिकॉज दे ऑल्सो आर एबल टू फ्लाई अ बिट ना, थोड़ा सा तो फ्लाई करते हैं फीमेल पीकॉक्स भी, पी हेंस दे आर कॉल्ड, राइट. सो बट देन दे आर नॉट एज ब्यूटिफुल एज पीकॉक्स, दैट्स देयर, एंड नॉट एज बल्की वॉल्यूमिनस ऑल्सो, राइट. सो इरिडेसेंट, दैट वॉज आर वर्ड. नाउ ऑड मैन आउट, आइडेंटिफाई द ऑड वर्ड आउट हियर. ओके in this question, and it is related to your previous slide. I'll tell you how once you answer. Okay, waiting. Yes, peacocks are more beautiful. Pratishtha. Good, Pratishtha has answered. Others? What do the others say? Jaldi jaldi batao. Okay, Isha says murk. Aman says typhoon. Oh, see this, they have just posted this message. 32 of you are watching and only 14 have liked the session. The others are not enjoying it. Okay, good. So, let me now tell you the answers. Some of you said gale, some of you said murk, some of you even said typhoon. Bahut sare answers aa gaye. Okay. Zephyr is the correct, I mean it's not the odd one out. It is related to typhoon and it is also related to gale. Okay, so I gave this question because of Zephyr. Okay, who is, I mean, where does the word come from? So Zephyr means a gentle breeze. Okay, a gentle breeze. So actually it comes from Zephyrus, who was the Greek god of wind. I just showed you Iris in the previous slide. So Iris and Zephyrus, they were husband and wife, okay? Consorts, that would be a more appropriate term. Okay, so that is why Iris used to carry these messages at the speed of wind, because she was with Zephyrus, okay? So Zephyr refers to a gentle breeze. Typhoon is a windstorm. Gale again is a strong wind. Okay, a strong wind, not used for a gentle wind. Gale. Murk is the odd one out here. This is the answer. Okay, murk means darkness. hic missed. That is what murk means. Okay, that's why we say, no, things have become murkier. When things become dark in a story, we say things became murkier, right? Things have become murky. So C is the odd one out here, and I gave this question to relate it with iridescent, zephyr. Okay, now in the morning session I told you we'll talk about somnambulism today. So break this word. Okay, I think the picture is very self-explanatory, right? So see this, somnus, if I break it, somnus and ambulism, amble, somnus aagya, amble aagya, and we have ism, right? So somnus, basically we have, actually see what happened was that mythology, philosophy, they first developed in Greece, okay? Then they spread to Rome. So what Romans did, they essentially copied a lot of philosophy and mythology from Greece. They just tweaked it a bit. So for instance, somnus and hypnos. Okay. I think one of them is Roman. Somnus is Roman or hypnos is Roman? Let me just quickly tell you. One of them is the Greek god of sleep. The other is the Roman god of sleep. Okay. So somnus is the Roman one. Ye wala hamara Roman hai, not Greek. And hypnos is the Greek god of sleep. Okay. So sleep, amble means to walk. We were discussing it right in the morning, right? Ism, it's used to make something a noun, right? So the trait of walking at night, basically sleepwalking, that is called somnambulism. What was another word that I told you in the morning for sleepwalking? There was another word. Noctambulism. So while noctambulism etymologically would mean walking at night, yet it is also used for sleepwalking. It's not like you, if you're taking a night stroll, you'll say, I am a noctambulist. That would be incorrect. Okay, so somnus, kitne sare words aate hain somnus se, see, insomnia, insomnia, have you heard this word somniloquy, somniloquy, a funny word, please don't use it for my sessions. So when what a person is saying is so boring that it induces sleep, that is a somniloquy, okay, so that is okay. And another meaning is somebody who talks in sleep. So whatever they say, that is also called a somniloquy. Okay, two meanings, right? So somnambulism, related word is noctambulism. Insomnia, when you can't sleep. Okay, these are related words. Now let's come to the Greek counterpart. Acha, before coming to the Greek counterpart, we have a few words here. Okay, you have to identify the odd word out. Tell me. Odd word out. Giving you 30 seconds, timing you. Okay, so I've got C and D by Aditya and Sahiti. Shivani says C. Okay, all right, let's see. Remember, in one of our editorial sessions, I talked to you about this word psychosomatic. Psychosomatic. Okay, this is TIC. So I told you soma is a root that means body. So somatology is a study of human body, okay, in the light of human evolution. A study of human body in the light of human evolution, that is somatology. It has nothing to do with sleep. This is our answer. See, it is the odd word out. Okay, somnus, somnus. Ye to related the. Right away you could see this. Okay, so somebody who walks in sleep, somebody that in something that induces sleep. Somniferous. So let's say a somniferous lecture induces sleep. Right? Somniloquy, talking in sleep. Somniferous lecture, sleep inducing lecture. Soporific lecture, again the same thing. They are synonyms. Soporific. Okay, this again induces sleep. Okay, so it is C, that is the odd word out. All right, so it was related to somnus. Now let's come to hypnos. Okay, abhi humne Roman god dekha tha. Let's now see the Greek god of sleep. So there are so many gods. It's a polytheistic mythology. Okay, just like Hinduism, they also have a lot of gods. All right, hypnagogic, hypnopompic. Hypnagogic. Agojos means to lead. This means sleep. So hypnagogic, actually these are psychological terms. You know, there's this time when you're just about to sleep, but you're not quite yet asleep. Aisa state aata na ek sote time, right? So that is called a hypnagogic state. Right? When you are just about to sleep, but you are not quite asleep. A hypnagogic state which leads you to sleep eventually. Hypnopompic, okay, pompic here basically shows that you are getting away from sleep, getting away. So that moment when you are about to wake up, but you are not quite awake, okay, you're about to wake up from your sleep, but you're not quite awake, that state is called a hypnopompic state, hypnopompic state. So hypnos, related to sleep, we have hypnosis, okay, a hypnotic state, hypnosis. So you are aware of this word already, this root already. Okay, I included this quote because I really, really like it. It's from Peter Pan. Okay, so Peter Pan, when he's going away to the planet that he's come from, then one of the characters, one of the children says this to him. You know that place between sleep and awake? When you're neither awake nor you are quite asleep. So perhaps she's talking about this hypnopompic state. You know that place? The place where you can still remember dreaming? That's where I'll always love you. That's where I'll be waiting. Because the children want to connect with him, right? So, yeah, this is about hypnos. All right. Chalo, let's see a new question. It's not related to your previous slides. Let me see what you mark here. High five, Pratishtha. Okay. His answer is answered. Waiting, looking in the chat box. C, okay. Pratishtha and Aman say C. A, Shivani says A. Aditya also says A. Okay, so I've got A and C. Any other option? Okay, let's see. Cornucopia. Cornucopia. First, let's see what this word means. Then I'll come to this question. Okay, so basically, cornu is, it's a horn. Okay, and copia means plenty. The horn of plenty. So again, In Greek mythology, there's this story about Zeus. Okay, so Zeus, when he was born, he was blessed with a horn by the gods. All the gods blessed him with a horn, and this horn could give foods and drinks in unlimited amounts. Okay, it was a goat's horn, a ram's horn to be more specific, and it could give unlimited quantities of food and drinks to him, right? So this horn is called cornucopia, and from then on in English, okay, from then on, so this term was later adopted by English, cornucopia. It means something that is available in large amounts, abundance, okay, sometimes even more than what is necessary. So our answer here would be superfluousness, when something is available in more quantities than necessary. Okay, abundance is a synonym, right? Nearest find out karna tha hume. Read the instructions very, very carefully, okay? Here I have very clearly written, but that won't be the case in your exam. So A is the answer. Meager. If something is meager, it's actually the opposite of cornucopia. That means present in less amounts, okay? Present in small quantity, in a less amount. So if I say his meager earnings, that means he earns relatively less. Sumptuousness. Okay. While this may appear related with abundance, with superfluousness, it's not. Okay. Sumptuous, if I talk about a meal and I call it a sumptuous meal, that means it was a very lavish meal. Okay. It was full of delicacies. Okay. It was a luxurious meal. That's the idea. So sumptuousness is related to lavishness, related to luxury, and not really related to abundance. Okay, of course, a sumptuous meal could be an abundant meal also. That's the case. But it's not necessary, na? So that's why this is not the answer, though this was a close option. And last one, sparing. Sparing.
So there are four.
Yes, tell me. So, if I say sparing, that means something again that is present in small amount. Okay, sparing quantity, small amount. Okay, right. Kisan is asking if utopian and cornucopia, they are similar. No, utopia, okay, or something that is utopian, if I'm looking at the adjective, it means something that presents an ideal situation where everybody is happy, everything is right. That would be a utopian condition. And it is usually said that you can't achieve that state. Okay, so it's not related to cornucopia. Just that this suffix is the same, probably that's why this an, which indicates that something has a quality of something. That is the same. The opposite of utopia is dystopia. Okay, so a dystopian world where again, everything is going wrong. Everybody is unhappy. That would be a dystopian world. It's a whole genre of novels. Okay. Dystopian novels. Like 1984 by George Orwell. It's a dystopian novel. The Handmaid's Tale by Margaret Atwood. It's a dystopian novel. Right. So this is a whole genre of writing. Okay. All right. Coming to our next slide. Yes, so this was our slide. And yes, I wanted to highlight that the word copious is also related. If you have something in copious amounts, you have it in abundant amounts. Right? So I have made copious notes for the exam. That means a lot of notes for the exam. Right? Okay. Now, coming to less is more. So laconic. I actually put the pictures of these pigeons here. So, synonyms of laconic are given to you. I think you'll understand this word very, very easily. Something that is terse, concise, brief, okay, succinct, short, crisp, pithy, curt. Curt would have a negative connotation. When you give a curt reply, that means it's very short. Again, terse would have a slightly negative connotation. Okay, brief, concise, short, succinct, they are okay. No negative connotations. So basically, synonyms jo words hote hai na, that does not mean they are exact substitutes. They are not exact substitutes. They are just similar words. Their connotations might vary. Okay, so curt, terse, negative. Brief, neutral. Concise, neutral. Okay, succinct, neutral. Short, neutral. Okay, a pithy saying. Again, it doesn't carry a negative connotation. Crisp, you would perhaps even like something that's crisp. Okay, so synonyms are similar words. Okay, iski story bahut interesting hai. Has anybody read the story in Word Power Made Easy? Laconic ka story? And remembers it? This tells me that you haven't done Word Power Made Easy. Okay, it's a very good vocabulary book. Good to learn vocabulary through etymology. Okay, so Laconic, it comes from the name of this region. Earlier there used to be this region called Laconia, which used to cover Greece, modern day Greece, and some other adjoining parts. That was Laconia. The people of this region, they were very precise, concise in their speech. Okay, so Laconic is usually concerned with speech. So these people were very precise. Now, what happened that once an invader tried to invade Laconia. So he was standing on the boundary of the city and he wrote a letter to the king. In the letter, he wrote that, you know, if I enter your town, I am going to destroy your houses. I am going to plunder all your wealth. I am going to rape all your women. Okay, so he wrote such a gory letter to him. Now, the king, when he received the letter, he saw that the backside of the letter was empty. Okay, so he just wrote if on the backside and sent it back. Because how did the letter of the invader began? If I enter, if I cross the boundary, I'll do this, 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 this. So he just wrote, the king just wrote an if and then sent it back. Okay, so this is the interesting story behind the word Laconic. You'll find it in Word Power Made Easy. Okay. Now, Spartan. Yes, Spartan. Laconic is concerned with speech. Somebody who's to the point in his or her speech. Spartan comes from Sparta. If somebody has seen 300, you would be aware of Sparta. Right? So the people of Sparta, if you've seen the movie, you would have seen they're very simply dressed. Even the king and the queen, they're very simply dressed. Both luxuries mein nahi reh rahe hain. Right? So, Spartan means somebody who is austere, somebody who lives very simply, a simple lifestyle. That person is Spartan. Comes from the region of Sparta where people lived very simply. So, this is being simple in your speech, simple and short. This is being simple in your lifestyle. Okay, both have Greek mythology origins. Right. Okay. So, now this is a more common term. I'm sure you'll tell me the meaning of Achilles' heel. Spartans live with very less amenities and without any luxury. Yes, Aditya, correct, correct. We can see that in the movie as well. Right. Achilles' heel. This is a common term. Yes, somebody's weakness. So, if you want the context, it means weakness in an overall strong person. But this weakness is enough to bring about his downfall. That is called his or her Achilles heel. Okay, so let's say you are good at aptitude. Okay, let's say last year you gave various entrance exams and overall you are good at aptitude. But then this one section posed a challenge for you in the exam. That very day, something happened. And that led to a low percentile last year. So that means that section was your Achilles heel. Okay. A weakness. So, right. Story. Interesting story. Achilles was a warrior, as you can see here. Okay. Now, when he was born, his mother wished for immortality for her son. So she asked gods to make her son immortal. So the gods granted that wish and they said that, you know, you have to dip him in this holy water. Okay, dip him in the holy, in a holy lake. There was a lake. Okay, and he'll become immortal. So when she dipped him, she held him by his heel. So everything got dipped, all his entire body got dipped except his heel. And once when he was fighting, his opponents came to know of this and they shot an arrow in his heel, because of which he died. So that is Achilles' heel. Right? Yes. Absolutely correct, Pratishtha. Yes, in SWOT analysis, the W would be your Achilles' heel. Right? Okay. So this is Achilles' heel, a relatively common term. Now, we've learned some words. So this match the following has some old words, some new words. I want you to look at all these eight, match them, answer in the chat box. Yes, giving you 1 minute for this. Do this. Okay, let me see. Yes, in the Trojan War. Correct, Pratishtha. The river's name was Styx, and yes, in the Trojan War, he got hit. Absolutely. You can even check the meaning of the word Trojan horse. Okay, it's used in a particular context. So, Kisano is saying, see, 5 is 1. Absolutely correct. 1 is 4. Again, correct. We have done these two words. 2 is second itself. Absolutely correct. 4, you say, is 2. No. 7, Pratishtha is saying, is 3. Correct. Midas touch. Correct. 2, okay, correct. 5, we have done. Aphrodisiac, अच्छा तो ये सब हमने कर लिया. मुझे न्यू वर्ड्स के बताओ. ओडिसी 3. व्हाट इज एन ओडिसी? So, Homer was a person, just like, you know, here Vedvyas wrote Mahabharata, Valmiki wrote Ramayana. So, Homer wrote a famous epic called the Iliad. In that, in one of his stories, there was this story about a person, Odysseus. Okay, the protagonist's name was Odysseus. So, Odysseus takes a very long and eventful journey and comes back to his home after many years. Okay, in this journey, he learns a lot of things. He faces a lot of challenges. So, Odyssey from there is called a long and eventful journey. 3 is 7. Okay, now let's see the next new word, Atlantean. Okay, you heard of... Okay, Atlas sabne dekhi hai. What does Atlas have? Map of the world. Have you ever wondered why it is called Atlas? Atlas was again a Greek god. He was punished by the gods and he was asked to carry the weight of the entire world on his shoulders. You must have seen this statue where there is this person who's carrying the globe on his shoulders. That is Atlas. So Atlantean comes from there, from Atlas, and it means somebody who's, let's say, or something that requires a great weight or burden of responsibility. Okay, referring to a great weight or burden of responsibility, that is Atlantean. Okay, and there is this popular novel by Ayn Rand, Atlas Shrugged. So I love the title, Atlas Shrugged. what would happen if one day, let's say, Atlas said, बहुत हो गया, मैंने कर रहा weight of the world on my own shoulders. So what if Atlas shrugged? What if people who are carrying the weight of the world on their shoulders one day choose to shrug? That forms an underlying theme of this book by Ayn Rand. Okay, for all their flaws, I love both the books by Ayn Rand, The Fountainhead and Atlas Shrugged. Very interesting storytelling. Okay, coming to Achilles' heel, that you know. Plutocracy, Plutos, you know, in Greece, planets, in Greek mythology, planets are also worshipped. Okay, so planets mein, jo Pluto hai, that is personified as the god of wealth. Although chota sa planet hai, but personified as the god of wealth. Plutocracy, democracy, bureaucracy. We did a passage on meritocracy. So crack means rule. So plutocracy means a regime of the wealthy. Right here you have the meaning. Okay. So where wealthy people rule, that is a plutocracy. So indirectly, some of the democratic countries could be plutocracies. Some of the monarchies could be plutocracy because it's the wealthy people that are essentially ruling. Right? Midas touch, sabko pata hai. Theek hai? So Mercurial is the only one that's left. And the answer is capricious. Who is a capricious person? Yes. Aditya, any idea? Somebody, Atlantean is an adjective. Atlantean is an adjective, kisan. So a mercurial, mercury has this property that it fluctuates a lot. That's why it's used in thermometers. So a mercurial person is a person whose, temperament changes very quickly. Somebody who's short tempered, very fickle minded also. That person is mercurial. Okay, so capricious, mercurial, they are synonyms, similar words. Somebody who is very fickle-minded, changes his or her moods very quickly, short-tempered, mercurial person. Yes, correct. Midas touch, yes, I'll explain it again. Midas touch is basically, if I decipher the meaning, the touch of a person who can turn anything into gold. So the touch of a person who basically, today gold would be money, right? So basically, he can make money in any venture. This uncanny ability of making money in every venture, this is called Midas touch. So you would use it like this. He's if you're discussing a friend, oh yes, he has launched a new startup. Anyway, he has a Midas touch. I'm sure the startup will be successful. Right? That's how you would use it. So this match the following format is very common in IIFT. Okay, sometimes asks vocabulary like this only. So even if you know the meanings of a few words, because options are also given there. Right now I made it tricky for you by not giving you options. You can eliminate and then mark the answer. Okay, so agar kuch bhi pata hai, even if you know 4 out of 8, you'll be able to mark the answer most likely. Right? Unless the options are very close. Right, so Aditya has got quite a few correct. I think Aditya got all of them correct. Is it? That's why you're blushing. Right. Okay. Good participation today, right? A cantankerous person is an irritable person. Yes. He could be capricious. Yes, could be. Right? All right. So this was a session on Greek mythology from my end. I'm sure you learned some new vocabulary words today, and they are useful words. They are words that we use commonly. Okay, I didn't give anything that you would not use. Right? So this is it from my side. Now you know about this MHCET course that we have launched. Okay, in case you're targeting it, do join it. Okay, we have some really good teachers teaching here. See, Pranav sir is himself an AIR2 in MHCET. A lot of you know Sanojam sir. Okay, Vikas Daya sir, you've attended their sessions. So do join them. Right, then this is our super subscription, our CAT courses and our non-CAT courses. Right, so CAT 21 and 22, both are available right now. Okay. And of course, the HOT exam and the other non-CAT exams, they also we cover. Right. This is our team. Right. Have a look. I think you've attended sessions by all of them. If not, then you can attend them on YouTube. We have free live sessions here as well as on our GradeUp app. Okay. You can attend them anywhere. These are our super subscription plans, CAT 21 and CAT 22. I think I've already shown you the snapshot of the exams that we are covering. Okay, these are the details. So you can have a quick look. Okay, you do get free internet with every super subscription that you take, right? And very important, this is our free live mock that is happening, the Mega Mock Challenge. Do take this mock, analyze it, okay? Get your queries clarified. We do have analysis sessions also after various mocks, okay? So they are free, you can attend those analysis sessions also, okay? Check your preparedness, right? And yes, follow us on Telegram. I conduct editorial sessions every day where I send you the full article over Telegram, right? I give you some tasks also. So in order to receive updates of such content, information, syllabus of various exams, notes, etc., do join our Telegram group, right? Welcome. Thank you so much. I really liked that you liked the session. Okay, please show all of this by liking the session, right? I'll see you next time. Bye. Have fun.